Welcome, Faith Community friends and family. As we gather for worship today, we give thanks for Jesus' promise that wherever two or three are gathered in my name, there I am also. And we know that is more than enough. As always, in the midst of a world of disagreement, we love to begin our worship by confessing together the Apostles' Creed, a reminder of what's most important in our faith and a reminder of what we can all agree on as God's people. And so we confess, please join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue our worship.
Amen. Faith family, how you feeling this morning?
Good.
Yeah, you feeling good? Is anybody excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Anybody?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Say it like you mean it. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Well, as you can see, we have a little ensemble over here. We you know, we're over here. We're going to have a little bit of fun. And, you know, I've been doing a lot of these medleys and stuff, and Lucas got jealous. He said he wanted in on it. So he said he wanted to get some country in here today. So I wore my Dolly Parton shirt. And if it's okay with you, we're going to do some Southern songs for you this morning, if that's all right with you. Your message is about the journey, right? The road?
Yes.
So why don't we sing about songs that talk about the journey here today? The first one goes like this. You going to help us sing, right? You going to help us sing, right? All right, here we go. First one goes like this. One, two, three. On the road again.
For to carry me home.
of praise if you believe it this morning. Yeah, we got one more left. This is an old song. We had to go way back to get this one. Uncover this one for you. But it's one of my favorites. It goes like this. Sound good this morning, Faith Community. You sound good this morning. You know, as I was preparing for this week, I was reminded of, as we walk with God, as we just sang, just a closer walk with Thee, right? We all want a closer walk with our Heavenly Father. But whether you've been in church just a few days or you've been in church a whole lot of years, you know that when you do get closer to Him, sometimes He likes to point out some blind spots. Amen? Does anybody got any blind spots in here? If I asked your spouse, I bet you they'd shoot their hands up like, "Hey, you got some, you got a lot of blind spots." But the beauty of our God and how gentle He is and what a gentleman He is that He will remind us of these blind spots, you know, in ways that we can get better, in ways that we can love better, in ways that we can have more grace and patience in our lives. And then we are left with a choice. We can either listen and make changes and spend some time evaluating our hearts and our minds, or we can not listen and keep just going on about our business. And then, you know, because God is so good, He'll remind us again at some point. I heard a pastor, a preacher say, if you don't reform, you only revisit. Amen? And so I was challenged with that this week of, all right, God, search me and know me. And if I have these blind spots, which we all just agreed that we all do, give me an open heart to receive how you would have me correct them. Because at the end of the day, I know because I've been hanging out with y'all for a while. I know the cry of your heart is to just be more like him, huh? And so the only way to do that is to let him kind of do heart work every time that we walk with him, when we come to church, and let him just have his way, to let him do his thing, as I like to say. But you do have a choice. So this next song is about that choice. And just saying, God, you know what? Open the eyes of my heart. I just want to see you. I want to see what you're doing in my life. I want to hear your voice when you speak. And I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it. I don't know about you, but I don't want to miss God in my life. Amen?
Amen.
So if you believe that this morning, help me sing this song.
Open the eyes of my heart.
Father, you are holy and you are so good. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. We open our hearts and our minds to you. Have your way in our hearts as we uncover the things that you have for us. Father, let us seek you on this journey, seek you on this road. When you speak, may we listen. In Jesus' name, we thank you. And everybody said, amen.
Hey, give it up for Chaz for going down that country road with us this morning. That was good. I've been bugging him since he got here to do some country, so we finally got it there. So that was great. For those of you that didn't know, Chaz and his band, they got to play for an event where they gave an award to Russell Wilson on Thursday. So they did a worship event there, and that was pretty awesome. Russell Wilson's a nice guy, right, Chaz?
Yeah.
Not as nice as Patrick Mahomes, but that's okay. I'm just kidding. I told him, they said there was a lot of people there. I said there would have been more if it was Patrick Mahomes, but that's okay. Well, hey, we are on the road again this morning talking about a journey here in Scripture. But before we get there, I want to share about a story that I heard this week about a lady that bought a parrot at a pet store. She was kind of a lonely lady, so she bought this parrot to take it home because she was hoping this parrot would talk to her. And so she gets this parrot home, she gets him into the cage that she set up. She sat there for hours staring at this parrot, but he didn't talk. And so she goes back to the store the next day and she says, the parrot didn't talk. And the manager said, well, maybe you should get a ladder. You see, parrots, they like to climb. They like exercise. And so she bought a ladder, took it home, put it into the cage. Parrot still didn't talk. The next day, she goes back to the store and she says, I bought the ladder, but the parrot still won't talk. He says, well, maybe you need a swing. You see, parrots, they like to swing back and forth a little bit. It puts them in a good mood. And so she bought a swing, took it home, put it in the cage. Parrot still didn't talk. She goes back to the store the next day. She says, I bought a swing, I bought a ladder, the parrot still won't talk. And the manager says, Well, you need a mirror. You see, parrots, they like to look at themselves. So buy a mirror, put it in the cage, it'll help. She takes the mirror home, puts it in the cage. The parrot's looking at himself. He's swinging back and forth. He's climbing the ladder. She comes back to the store the next day and tells the manager the parrot died. He said, the parrot died? How terrible. Did the parrot say anything before he died? She said, yeah, the parrot said, don't they sell food down there at the pet store? I'm hungry, lady. Poor parrot. There are a lot of us in our lives. We have ladders. We have mirrors. We have swings. We have all kinds of things that we think that we need in order to get through the journey of life. But what we will discover in our text today is that Jesus gives us exactly what we need to have an eternal, life-changing journey. We're in Luke chapter 24, and there are two people on a journey. And we will discover that it's not just a geographical journey, but it is a spiritual journey. And I think all of us here today are on a spiritual journey. And what we'll see from our text is that there are three things that we need to experience on our spiritual journeys. We need Jesus to meet us where we're at. We need Jesus to teach us. And we need Jesus to feed us. So with that, we're in Luke chapter 24. We're going to look at verses 13 through 16 to begin with here. The verses will be up here on the screen or in the Bibles in front of you. It says this. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. Now, the first thing I want to talk about this morning is how Jesus meets us on our journeys. You see, spiritual journeys, they often begin with questions. They begin with mystery. They begin with confusion. And that's exactly what happens with this couple here. Now, I say couple because I believe that this is a married couple. And some of you are like, Lucas, how do you know this is a married couple? I got a painting in my house where it looks like two men. But if you look close enough, one of them, I think, kind of looks like a woman. And you'll see here later why I think that this is a married couple. Again, we don't know that it's two men here, like this text is, like it is often attributed to this text. But what we see later on here is one man is mentioned, and his name is Cleopas. And it's very likely that this Cleopas is Clopas, who is mentioned in John chapter 19. And Clopas, we are told, had a wife. And so I believe that there is a good chance that this is a married couple. And they are traveling from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And like I said, it's not just a physical journey that they are on. They are on a spiritual journey. And they have a lot of questions. They are confused about all of the events of Good Friday, the crucifixion of Jesus. And the text says, as they talked and discussed with each other. But if you look at the Greek verb here, this word discussed is probably too polite of a word. It's too nice of a word. This is why I think they're a married couple. They're arguing, okay? They're having a heated debate because that happens in marriage sometimes. And we're left to speculate what the argument is about. Maybe one of them was more inclined to believe, and maybe the other was more of a skeptic. We don't know. We just know that they're having a heated exchange between them. And then they meet a stranger, and this stranger approaches them. They don't approach the stranger. He approaches them. And he walks alongside them and he initiates a conversation with them. Look at verse 17. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. Now he witnesses this heated exchange and he asks them what they're talking about. And it says that they responded by standing still with their faces downcast. Now why would they do that? Maybe perhaps they were annoyed by such an intrusive question from a stranger. Reminds me of a time when I was in India a few years back, and I was getting to travel all over India and meet these church plant pastors who were getting trained to go back into their villages and to risk their lives to share the gospel with the people in their hometowns. And there was a leader that started this ministry. And he has planted like 30,000 churches and has baptized over 100,000 people. And so towards the end of the trip, I got a chance to sit down and have dinner with this great leader. And like I often do, I put my foot in my mouth. Any of you have a problem with that? I do it on a daily basis. So I'm sitting down and I'm having dinner with this great leader and he's talking about his ministry and he's talking about his life. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to ask about his family. But instead, I asked how his marriage was. That's an awkward question to ask someone the first time you sit down and have dinner with them, isn't it? And he responded by saying to me, he said, "You Americans ask such intrusive questions." I think he was joking, but I'm not really sure. You see, maybe that's why this couple stood there still with their faces downcast. Somebody's intruding on their marital argument. Now, some say that there is great advice here for couples who are arguing. Do we have any married couples who've been arguing lately? There we got one hand. I'm just kidding. You don't need to raise your hands. We do offer free marriage counseling here. Maybe you were arguing on the way to church this morning. And some say, again, that through this text, it tells us that maybe we should bring our lives and our problems and our questions to Jesus. That is great advice for married couples. But I think the greater point in this text is that Jesus came to them. You see, Jesus meets us where we are in life. He meets us in our messiness, in our doubts, in our questions, in our arguments, in our confusion. And I love that Jesus initiates the conversation here. He says, "What is it you all are talking about?" I mean, he's Jesus. He knows what they're talking about, right? But he portrays ignorance here. And Cleopas pretty much says, he says, "Have you been living under a rock?" Starting in verse 18, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these days?" "What things?" he asked. About Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. Now, Cleopas thought about the Messiah the same way that most of his contemporaries did. They believed that the Messiah would come to deliver Israel from suffering. But what they didn't realize is that the Messiah would come to deliver them through suffering. Cleopas said, "It's been 3 days since Jesus died." Then it goes on to say in verse 22, "In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." Again, spiritual journeys begin with questions. They begin with mystery and oftentimes confusion. And on our spiritual journeys, we often alternate between despair and hope. And that's what's happening with this couple. They said, "We had great hope, but now we don't know what to think. It's been 3 days since Jesus was buried in the tomb, but there are reports that he is alive and that he's been raised from the dead." So the first thing we need on our spiritual journeys is we need Jesus to meet us right where we're at. But that's not enough. We also need Jesus to teach us. And that's what Jesus is doing in this story. You see, in our state of confusion, Jesus knows exactly what we need. In our discouragement, Jesus knows exactly what we need. And there's one tool that Jesus uses to minister to us in our times of need. There's one tool that Jesus employs to guide us in our times of darkness, where we don't know where else to turn. And that tool is the Word of God. It's the Bible. Now, we come to church with a variety of feelings, don't we? Sometimes we come here and we're happy. Other times we come here and we're sad. Sometimes we come here and we're feeling encouraged. Other times, discouraged. Sometimes we come here with clarity and sometimes with confusion. And what does Jesus say to us when we come to church? He says, "Come, gather around me. I have something that I want to say to you. I want to speak to you. I have something that I want to encourage you with." And he does that through Jesus' promises spoken through sermons that come straight out of the Bible. And that's why we pastors here at Faith Community place such an emphasis on preaching sermons that come straight out of the Bible. And we're going to continue to do that here. This is why we have the Bible. This is how Jesus guides us and encourages us. This is how he gives us faith where there is doubt. Now, Jesus lets Cleopas speak, but then you'll notice that he actually rebukes him. Look at verse 25 through 26. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" Now, what's the problem with Cleopas and his wife here? It's their negligence of Scripture. You see, if the Word of God is the means by which Jesus uses to minister to us and to guide us and to give us faith, then why do we oftentimes neglect it? Now, I'm speaking to myself here, if I'm being honest. How many opportunities have we had to read the Bible or to come to church and to hear Jesus teach through the preaching of the gospel? How many times have we forfeited those opportunities and experiences? I know I've forfeited a lot of those opportunities in my life. My other question for us is, how are we reading the Bible? I fear that what we often do is we read the Bible selectively. We cherry pick when we read the Bible. We can sometimes get caught up in treating the Bible like a spiritual buffet, where we gravitate towards the parts that we know and like, and we avoid the other parts of Scripture that we don't like. And you see, what happens when we do this is selective reading of the Bible oftentimes leads to selective obedience, where we start justifying our sins but ignoring other sins in the Bible. And that can make us judgmental as well. You see, Cleopas and his wife, they should have known better. Because the prophets had spoken about these things that they just witnessed and experienced for thousands of years. They should have known that the Messiah would not simply deliver Israel from suffering, that the Messiah would deliver Israel through suffering. And they should have known that suffering wasn't the end for the Messiah, that the cross was simply the pathway to glory. How foolish you are, Jesus says to them. And then it says, starting in verse 27, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all of the scriptures concerning himself. Now, what this is telling us is that every single thing that we find in the Bible, including the Old Testament, points to Jesus. So that when we scratch scripture, it bleeds Christ. New Testament, Old Testament, when we scratch the Word of God, it bleeds Christ. That's what Jesus is teaching to Cleopas and his wife. And wouldn't you have loved to have heard Jesus' sermon? I bet Jesus was pretty good at preaching, don't you? He's probably better than the Apostle Paul, who when he preached, people fell asleep, fell out of windows, and died. Now, he did raise him back to life, so maybe it was just a sermon illustration. I'm not really sure. But I bet Jesus was pretty good at preaching. You see what I imagine Jesus did here? Is I imagine that Jesus took them to the first book of Moses, the book of Genesis, and said to them, do you remember reading about the seed of the woman and how it would crush the head of the serpent? I am the seed of the woman. I imagine he took them to Genesis chapter 12, where we read about how through the seed of Abraham, all the nations of the world would be blessed. I imagine him saying, I am the seed of Abraham. I imagine Jesus taking them to the book of Exodus and saying, do you remember the Passover lamb whose blood was spilled so that Israel would be safe from the angel of death? I am the Passover lamb. I imagine Jesus taking them to the book of Leviticus and saying, do you remember the scapegoat who was sent into the wilderness carrying the sins of the people? I am the scapegoat. Beginning with Moses and the prophets, Jesus shows how all of the scriptures spoke concerning himself. And how does this couple respond to this sermon from Jesus? This walk through the story of scripture, unveiling Christ on every page? It says, starting in verse 31, then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? Is that not a rich image of the transformational effect that the Word of God has on people when it's opened? Their hearts burned with a flame of greater clarity, burning away their doubts, burning away their despair, burning away their confusion, burning away the mystery. Reminds me of what happened with John Wesley, the 18th century preacher. When he went to the chapel at Aldersgate, and while he was there, he read through the book of Romans. And after the fact, he wrote about this. And he said that while reading through Romans, his heart was strangely warmed. Because through the word, he was pointed to Jesus Christ. And I've had this happen numerous times in my life. I've talked about this a lot. I've struggled with doubt quite a bit. I've struggled with shame. But there have been so many times in my life where in my darkest moments, I was able to open up the Word of God and have it change my life. In fact, one of those times was when I was in a small Bible college up in Canada, and we had to be a part of a ministry, and we got to choose what ministry to be a part of. And so nobody wanted to go and do the prison ministry, so I thought I would go there. And so what I didn't realize is that they were going to leave me in a room with over 100 inmates by myself to lead a Bible study. And so I showed up there, and I learned very quickly that if you show up to a Bible study there, you should be prepared, because they don't have anything else to do all day but read the Bible, so they know it. And it was a great year getting to be with them. And towards the end of the year, I had asked them, I said, have any of you had a passage in the Bible that has radically changed your life? And this one guy stands up, and he's a pretty intimidating guy, and he starts talking about how he's spending the rest of his life in prison. I didn't really want to find out why, but he started sharing about his story. And he started sharing about why he was grateful that he was spending the rest of his life in prison. Because in prison, Jesus came to him, met him where he was at. He started reading the Word of God, and it changed his life. So, yes, he's in prison for the rest of his life here on earth, but he will now be in heaven forever with Jesus. And so he got up and he started sharing about this passage in Genesis about Jacob wrestling with the angel of God. And even though that Jacob was a deceiver and was doing all of these things, God still cared enough to meet Jacob, to wrestle with him, and to change his life forever. And that passage had such a transformational impact on my life. In fact, a couple weeks later, I got it tattooed right here on my arms. That's what I do when scripture impacts me. I just go get it tattooed all over me. So I encourage you to do the same thing. I'm just kidding. You see, the Word of God is central for Christian living. But what does the Bible teach? The Word of God presents Christ, who is essential for salvation. Now, I want to encourage you today that if you're reading through the Bible and you aren't encountering Christ, then you're probably not reading the Bible correctly. The Bible is not an accumulation of facts. The Bible is the presentation of the person of Jesus Christ. And as we read through Scripture, we're not just supposed to have our brains swell with information. We're supposed to be drawn to Christ so that He becomes preeminent in our lives. Now, I imagine the preeminence of Christ in the life of the Apostle Paul. I imagine it was apparent to everyone that was around him. But is the preeminence of Christ apparent to everybody in our lives? And I think that's a question that we have to ask ourselves. On our spiritual journeys, Jesus meets us where we are at, and He teaches us. But then He also feeds us. Look, starting at verse 28. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if He were going farther. But they urged Him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So He went in to stay with them. When He was at the table with them, He took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Now they finally have reached their destination. And Jesus indicates that He wants to go farther. But this couple, they urge Him to stay with them. They are hospitable to Jesus. They ask Jesus to stay with them. And Jesus, I think He does something pretty remarkable here. Remember, He's the guest in their home. But He starts acting like the host. It says that He took the bread, that He gave thanks, that He broke it and gave it to them. It's the very sequence of the Lord's Supper. This is the meal that Jesus wants us to have. This is the food that Jesus wants us to eat, which is why we do communion here every single week. And Luke, the writer of this gospel, wants us to think about the very first meal in the Bible. It's that meal that happened in the Garden of Eden when the serpent tried to seduce Adam and Eve to eat fruit from the forbidden tree. And it says in Genesis that the woman took of the fruit and ate it and gave it to her husband, and he also ate it. And then what does it say? It says the eyes of both of them were open, and they discovered that they were naked. And now Jesus gives this couple in Luke chapter 24 another meal. He takes bread, He breaks it, He gives it to them. And the text says that the eyes of both of them were opened. They didn't open their eyes themselves. Their eyes were open, and then they finally recognized Jesus. And they discovered not that they were naked. They discovered that they were clothed with the righteousness of Christ. They recognized the risen Jesus. They knew who He was. They knew what it meant. The curse had been broken. The penalty for sin had been paid. The power of death has been defeated, and now they have reason for hope, for a new life as new creations in Christ. Maybe you're here this morning and maybe you're spiritual, but you're not religious. Maybe you're here this morning and you're what they call a spiritual nun, unaffiliated with any religious organization. And if that's you this morning, you are welcomed here. Maybe you're here and you're skeptical of the claims of Christ and you just can't possibly believe in the resurrection. You see, here's the deal. I don't think anybody will ever be convinced of the resurrection by a series of logical arguments. I don't know of anybody who's ever been convinced of the resurrection by a series of logical arguments. What I think that you need and what I think all of us need is the Emmaus experience. Do you want the Emmaus experience in your life today? I think all of us do. I think all of us want our hearts to burn and our eyes to be open to see Jesus every day in our lives. I think all of us want the kind of experience that Cleopas and his wife had. And what this passage is teaching us is that the Emmaus experience is available every single time we come together for worship. Because worship is the place where Jesus meets us right where we are. In whatever state we are in whatever mindset we have, in our confusion, in our doubts, in our skepticism, in our anxiety, in our depression, in our addictions, in our grieving, and also in our joy. Whatever it is, this is the place where Jesus meets us. And this is also the place where Jesus teaches us through the preaching of the gospel that proclaims to us that while we were still sinners, Christ went to the cross and died for us. And 3 days later, rose again so that through faith in him, we will be in heaven forever. And this is the place where Jesus feeds us in our oftentimes uninformed, weak faith. This is where Jesus feeds us with the Lord's Supper, which is a means of grace by which God speaks this promise into your ear. You are forgiven. Again, that's why we do communion here every single week. That's how Jesus feeds us. Now, I'm going to end with one of my all-time favorite movies, a clip from one of my all-time favorite movies that I think really underscores all that we've been talking about today. It's from the movie Forrest Gump.
That day, for no particular reason, I decided to go for a little run. So I ran to the end of the road. And when I got there, I thought maybe I'd run to the end of town.
President Carter, suffering from heat exhaustion, fell into the arms
of... When I got there, I thought maybe I'd just run across Greenbow County. And I figured since I run this far, maybe I'd just run across the great state of Alabama. And that's what I did. I ran clear across Alabama. For no particular reason, I just kept on going. I ran clear to the ocean. And when I got there, I figured since I'd gone this far, I might as well turn around, just keep on going. When I got to another ocean, I figured since I'd gone this far, I might as well just turn back, keep right on going. When I got tired, I slept. When I got hungry, I ate. When I had to go, you know, I went.
And so you just ran.
Yeah.
You see, our lives are like long treks, aren't they? Long journeys. And every journey has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And as followers of Christ, we may think of the Christian life as a long journey with Jesus in the same direction. And some of us have yet to begin our journey with Jesus. Others of us are well on our way. And maybe some of us are nearing the end of our journey. wherever you're at in your walk with Jesus, I pray that you would have the same attitude as Forrest Gump. Since I've gone this far with Jesus, I might as well just keep on going. And I pray no matter what it is you're going through today, I pray that you would just keep on going with Jesus until you reach your final destination. And that is in the arms of the risen Jesus. May the risen Christ be real in your heart today and in your life every day. Please, let's pray. God, we thank you for this morning. God, we thank you for this time to gather together as a church family. God, we come here in all kinds of ways, God, with all kinds of different baggage and things going on in our lives. And God, I thank you, God, that if we walked in here today with confusion, if we walked in here with doubt, anger, addictions, whatever it is, God, I thank you that you're willing to meet with us right here where we are at. And God, I pray that your presence would be felt amongst everybody who is here today. God, that they would know that you're real in their heart. God, that they would experience your power, your peace, and your love like maybe they've never felt before. And may your promises to them provide faith where there is doubt today. And God, I pray that your promises would give us all the strength that we need to get through whatever it is that happens in our journey this next week and the week after that. And I thank you, God, at the end of our journeys, God, that we get to be embraced by your arms forever. Pray these things in your name. Amen.
As we celebrate Holy Communion today, we invite you to use whatever you have available in your home setting, whether that would be bread or crackers or grape juice or wine. We invite you to join us as we remember again the words of institution. That it was in the night which he was betrayed that our Lord Jesus took bread. He broke it and he gave thanks and he gave it to his disciples saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this to remember me. And again in the same manner he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it to all to drink saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this to remember me. So take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. Please join me as we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thanks for worshiping with us today. We are thankful for your presence and the ability to be together online in this community. We'd just like to remind you that there are many ways that we worship and we serve God, and we are good stewards of what we have. And so we continue to offer online giving. You may also write a check if you'd like to and mail it into the church, or if you're local and want to come by and drop it off, that would be great too. We have seen God be so faithful in his provision and the way that he has been able to work through this congregation because of your generosity. Over and over again, we just hear amazing stories of how he is able to do that. And so we appreciate you being faithful in your giving financially as well. Remember to check the website. There are all sorts of great things going on here, and the website has our most current information. We'd love to get you connected even more with this congregation. And so check the website to see what's going on. Thanks again for being with us.